Welcome to Corrective Consciousness, episode 26. I am your host, Vise the Bold, and this is...
Lotus Prince.
And I'm Parajack Frost.
And hi, I'm Minty Mitz, back again.
Oh, snap.
Hi, guys.
What's up?
Minty Mitz is gonna fuck your shit up.
Okay.
Well, we're going to hope to keep the segment under X amount of time, remember, guys? So I can't be fucking too much shit up. Cough.
Well, last time I saw you, you were breaking stuff, so.
That can still be true in terms of certain things. Lots of thread counts have been lost.
Oh, no.
Fortunately, my controllers are not broken though, so that's all good.
That's good. So you can still play.
Yes.
Well, this is our first podcast of the new year. So
yes,
I know Lotus Prince will be very happy to see 2016 go because it's ruined his social media presence.
Oh, absolutely.
He's more mad at people that hate 2016 than actual people.
No, I'm not mad at... I guess you could say that. Like, yeah, like, just... If you're on social media of any kind, you've probably seen this a bunch of times. Whenever a celebrity dies, people are like, you know, damn you, 2016. And it's like, on one hand, I get it. There's a lot of celebrity deaths in 2016. But at the same time, do you think they're just gonna stop dying now that January 1st happened? It just drives me crazy. Like, 2016 didn't kill them.
I think everyone's gonna stop dying now.
Okay.
I think we're in a Sliders episode, guys.
You know, I never actually watched Sliders, but I heard it went way downhill.
Well, Sliders was really good because it, like, was basically... Imagine Twilight Zone, but it has continuity.
That's cool, but I heard that, like... After, like, some season, just everything went straight to hell.
It did, but, like, I think season 3, because one of the actors left and his in-show brother took over his spot, but everything up to that was good enough that...
His real brother actually played his in-show brother.
Yeah.
Which is kind of funny.
And I don't
Jerry O'Connell's brother.
I don't recommend not watching it just because it goes downhill.
Okay.
Yeah, the first 3 seasons are quite good. Though some of the plot lines are pretty cool. It's like, so if anybody doesn't know, it's basically a show about a group of people who get stuck
really small
hopping
hamburgers.
Yes, especially from like White Castle. No, no. So what happens is these people get stuck going from dimension to dimension. And they're trying to find their way home. Their device is broken and has a countdown to when they get sucked into the next parallel dimension. Mm. So each of these parallel dimensions has like something slightly different with it to something very different about it. Mm-hmm. There was one episode where there was a dinosaur planet, for instance, a dinosaur Earth.
I think the first episode was really cool in the way that when the main character first finds out that he can slide, he doesn't realize he has, and he's trying to drive back home, and he's stopped at a red light, and everyone's honking at him, and then the light turns green, and he goes, and he almost gets into an accident.
Because in this alternate
universe, the
dimension difference.
The only thing that's different is red means go, green means stop.
That's so weird. That's like when Homer finally gets back to the right dimension, and everything's the way it should be, but all of a sudden, like, everyone starts eating their food with snake tongues, and he's just like, eh, close enough. He just goes to eating.
What's cool about it is that they eventually get back to their own dimension, like, the right one, mm-hmm. Like, in mid-series, but they find out they don't want to be there because aliens just took over.
Oh, wow.
It's, like, awful. Yeah, it's just like, oh... Well,
that's kind of brilliant.
You wanted to get back, but you didn't like it.
Interesting.
That was a place you did not want to be. It's kind of cool because it has that overall theme of, like, home is where you make it. Like, mm-hmm. You should just kind of, like, drop what you're... Like, shit can happen anywhere you are. Like, nothing's ever going to be perfect. You should just, like, you know, find a place that's good enough and then deal with any problems that you have later.
It kind of reminds me of Rick and Morty when they just basically ruin the entire world so Rick takes them to a dimension where their other selves just died, and also they did not ruin everything, so they could just take over their roles.
Yeah, and that's the only difference in the entire dimension is just that. Having said that, we should move on to our first segment. So I believe Pyro wants to take it.
All right, so again, I'll have my little Bloodborne minute. I beat another two bosses, I think. I'm trying to remember where I left off last time. I find it interesting because either these bosses were really easy, or it's like last time, I'm getting the hang of it. They're just really easy, or I'm overleveled. I have a feeling it's because I'm overleveled. So the bosses that I fought, one was the bosses of the Forbidden Woods, which I don't know if I talked about last time, but there's these three guys that you have to fight. I don't know. Have either of you... How far have either of you gotten, any of you gotten in Bloodborne?
Well, zero, but I've seen a playthrough.
A full playthrough?
Yeah.
Okay.
So I got all the way to the hidden village, you know, where you get kidnapped to. Then slightly after...
What was that?
I might end up playing Bloodborne later, but I don't mind listening to anything now. I'll probably forget it until I get to that part, and I'll be like, oh.
Mm.
And Vice, what were you saying?
Oh, I said I got basically to the part right after, right after the kidnappers are. So not much further.
Oh, okay.
I was trying to beat the that electric boss in the... the village there, the hidden village, and I just can't beat him for whatever reason. He's just really hard for me.
Okay. Yeah, so there's these three guys you have to fight at the same time, and once you kill one of them, the other two get harder. And then once you kill two of them, the last one can summon these like giant snakes that just do massive damage. But they weren't that bad, and then I got another boss that was just a giant amygdala, I think they're called. They're those giant guys that are invisible until you have a certain amount of...
Oh, yeah, those things are ridiculous.
Insight. Yeah, so you have to fight one of them. It's like a secret
area. You need to have a certain insanity count, right?
To fight the boss, but to see the ones that are just
chilling around
the world. Yeah.
That's so freaky.
Yeah, so I got there, and right now I'm trying to go through the castle. So, Lotus Prince, if you remember that, it's the castle with, like, the vampire-type things and ghosts.
Maybe.
But anyway, so that was Bloodborne. I'm still sticking through it, and I'm proud of myself, and we'll see how much longer I last. I played a little bit more Shantae today. I know I complained a little bit last week about how there's kind of repetitive and you're just going through the same areas, and while that's still true, I'm starting to get the hang of that fact, and it's... still a little fun uncovering new things, but it's kind of annoying where you go to an area, get as much as you can, go to another area, get a new power, meaning you have to go back to that previous area and explore that again, and it's just back and forth, and it's fun, but when I beat it, I'm going to be like, okay, cool, I'm done. Let's push it aside.
Yeah, it's probably sure. A little cooler if you can go back for maybe one or two mandatory things, but like mostly optional stuff. Like, oh, I have cool powers, so I can look for the weirdness. But if you just want to beat the game, it does feel a little obnoxious if you're forced to just retread everything.
Mm-hmm. And then one other thing is, like, if I know what I have to get with what power, I have to use that power through the whole area, so I kind of remember that I've used it.
Okay.
So I don't need to... Because I unless I want to just go searching through everything again at the very end, but whatever, I'll see if I feel like doing that or just beating it and being done with it. So the other thing I wanted to mention, kind of connecting two things. So with the new year, a party that I went to was tons of board games being played, and I got a new board game called Above and Below, and it's really cool. The really simple explanation is you're trying to build a village, hire villagers, build buildings, and explore this underground cavern. And the cool gimmick about this game is when you explore an underground cavern, you draw a card that has six numbers that you have to roll a dice to see which number you get, and there's a big book of encounters it comes with. And you read that entry, and it kind of becomes a choose-your-own-adventure. So you read, like,
oh, really?
A little
cool
story, like a mini story, and then you get, like, two options. and then you have to pick one of them, and you have to roll based on how what you want to do, and you might may or may not get rewards. It's a really cool idea. I'll be bringing it to MAGFest if we can get a chance to play it, but it's a really fun game.
Yeah, it sounds pretty sweet.
I can't wait, yeah.
And then
it sounds like a lot of fun.
Yeah, and it was a lot of fun. And I played a lot of other board games, but some that I've already mentioned before, so I'm not going to really explain that too much. The only other thing I really wanted to talk, two things I wanted to talk about is I saw Swiss Army Man again.
So
good.
Oh, man.
Yeah, because one of our friends brought it over. And it's interesting because when we watch it, because the three of us, like, not Minty, but the other three of us watch it in the theaters.
I watched it with you guys.
Oh, you were there with us?
Yes.
Oh,
yes, I was.
Sorry about that.
No, she was there.
Well.
Okay. Yeah, so we all watched it in the theater. And the funny thing was that when I saw it in the theaters, it felt like it was long to me. Because the whole time I'm like, what's going on? Like, what? This is such a strange movie. I'm so interested in seeing what comes next. But then when I watched it over the weekend, it went by so fast. Like, I guess because I could see what was coming, but it was just everything. It felt like a much shorter movie the second time around. And
I think it has like a, like when you don't know what's happening in that movie, the pace seems slow, I guess. Mm-hmm. But like, you know what's going to happen, and like, you know what, where the movie is going. Like, mm-hmm. like when you first start watching that movie, like the first half hour, you're like, what are they going to be doing here?
Yeah.
Like, you know, like you have no idea what, where the movie's going from there.
Yeah. And it's like, when you've seen the movie, like, it's fun watching it again, knowing what happens, and like trying to figure out if you could have figured that out earlier or not, and like kind of see what's going on, like, without like plot twists or anything, but see if the guy's really dead or not. You know what I'm saying?
What I don't understand is how somebody was able to come up with an idea for this and then convince a lot of other people to make it.
Well, yeah, really.
I don't know if
because it's fantastic, but it's like weird as shit.
Yeah, I don't know if
and funny
knew
as
this,
hell.
But have you watched the music video for "Turn It Down for What"?
Yes.
No.
With the boner that the guy with the boner that moves.
No.
Okay, you need to see this at some time, but. You can now watch that music video knowing that the people who directed that music video directed the movie.
Oh.
Oh.
So those wow. of you who've seen the music video can and watched the movie kind of can see some similarities between
nice.
Their style.
That's kind of amazing.
See,
I can't wait to watch the movie again. I haven't seen it. Oh, go ahead.
Oh, no, I was just saying that, like, it takes a certain type of people with certain types of imagination because, like, Swiss Army Man is kind of a... You definitely know it's not a mainstream type of action movie type of comedy type of movie. It might be really difficult to swallow for a lot of people to understand.
My parents wouldn't like it at all.
It's, yeah.
That's for sure.
Oh, you need a group of directors, a group of actors, and everybody who was involved in this movie to be able to swallow some sort of a sense of humor to understand what's happening in this movie.
That movie and 10 Cloverfield Lane were my favorite movies of 2016.
I would like to still watch 10 Cloverfield Lane. I haven't seen Cloverfield.
Really good.
I know they're not connected, but kind of part of me feels like I need to watch Cloverfield first.
They're just thematically linked, I guess you could say.
Mm-hmm.
Like I can't really discuss it with you because the connection is so tenuous that like you have to theorize about it.
Gotcha.
If that makes any sense. But
mm-hmm.
it is connected, but not. You kind of have to make a stretch.
Okay.
I guess. But
all right. And yeah, so...
I like Cloverfield quite a bit, but 10 Cloverfield Lane is the better film.
Okay.
So,
okay.
Yeah.
So yeah, the last thing I wanted to talk about was so I started playing a new phone game. This also happened kind of over the weekend at the party. A few of us decided, like, have been playing phone games, and we all wanted to play the same one together. It's actually really fun. It's called Valkyrie Connect, So I've been seeing a lot of ads of this on Facebook, and I really didn't want to start a new game. But it's really fun because it's the usual, you pull random characters and they have different rarities. And not only do they have rarities, but like they have different frames, they're called. Like the borders around the characters tell you how strong they are. So there's the frame rarity and then like the star rarity. But anyway. But it's really cool because you can level them up and they all have their own story quests. It's like a Norse mythology kind of theme. It's an RPG. There's equipment, there's stats. It's actually really fun. And there's really a lot to do with it. So anyone who's looking for a really good RPG-ish phone game, I recommend checking out Valkyrie Connect.
I want to check that out. Is it... So it's like an RPG?
Yes and no. I mean, there's auto battle, but there's like everyone auto attacks, and every now and then when their meter fills, they can do a special attack, and then there's another meter that's being filled for your limit break, and when the limit break fills, you choose what character or characters you want to do the limit break. It's very much just like setting up your order, like how many short range guys do you want, mid range, long range, making sure they're good, high level and strong enough and have the good equipment. But other than that, it's really fun. There's like raids, there's arena, there's story, like the story mode, plus each character has their own story. So I find it really interesting. Yeah.
Nice. That's cool. I would like to play it for sure.
Yeah. So, I mean, I know that I went through a lot of that really quickly, but that was basically my week. Other than that, I'm just waiting for MAGFest, which is in work. I will be there in like 2 days, basically.
Yep.
Yeah, it's crazy.
Yeah.
So, I assume that we're going on Thursday morning, or when's it? Wednesday.
Well,
night?
I'm gonna be arriving around like 10 or 11.
I mean,
on Wednesday.
Because I have work.
Wednesday,
on Wednesday
or Thursday.
Well, yeah. I mean, I usually
Yeah.
I usually leave on Wednesday, so I get there and don't have to drive there on Thursday.
Well, we all have the rooms for Wednesday night.
Yeah.
Yes.
Okay. Nice. So anybody is going to be there should definitely contact us over the YouTube page and let us know. That way we can set a meetup and have some fun.
Mm-hmm.
All right. So Lotus Prince, what about you? How was your week?
It's pretty ho hum. As for I had talked about last week how my PlayStation Network account got hacked. So that's pretty much been taken care of. And by the way, yes, I did get the $50 refunded. So that was pretty cool.
Oh, nice.
The only thing that's irritating is that I had said that I had set up a 2-step verification process so that when I try logging in, I get a text telling me what my security code is, so I can punch that in, and then I'm in. Well, what was really freaking annoying is that, like, all morning yesterday and a couple days before, like, 40 times within, like, 2 hours, my phone, like, every couple of minutes, my phone was going off with verification codes
because
someone was trying to get in. And it was just such a royal pain in the ass. So I eventually just changed my email that I use to get into the PSN, and it seems to have gone away. But that's just such a freaking pain. But the problem seems to be over. Otherwise...
That's really annoying.
Yeah, like my phone keeps vibrating. Oh, what is it this time? Oh, it's message number 737 saying my verification code is this. Great.
Did you contact the PSN to let them know that it's...
No, I did, but they kind of...
trace it?
No, that's exactly what I did, but they can't do that. Which, in a way, is a good thing. I don't know if I like the ability for them to just be able to trace whatever. But, like, at the same time, that would have been nice that time. But they seem to be unable to do so. As for The Binding of Isaac, at this point, I think I only have, like, 9 achievements left. The problem is that they all suck, because I have to play with the Keeper, and I hate playing as the Keeper. But...
So,
what does the Keeper do?
Well, we had mentioned it briefly last week. The thing with the Keeper is he has a maximum of 2 health, and but his health is in the form of coins. Hearts don't even exist.
Okay.
Hearts turn into little flies that fly around him and can be used as sort of like one-shot sort of kamikaze ammo. But if you find coins, those can be used as health. So if you're missing health and you pick up a coin, it will not add to your money total, but it will contribute to your health. The problem is that you have a maximum of 2 health. If you get hit in a room, then you're just at one health for until you find the coin. It's really annoying. And he has a pretty sweet triple shot, but it fires pretty slowly, and the keeper's a little slow, so playing with him is just really unpleasant. However, the good news is that I managed to beat Mega Satan with a Lost, so I'm done with the Lost. That was hours of attempts with the Lost, trying to even get to Mega Satan. I think I only ever got to him like two or three times, and the third time was a charm. Oh, wow. So I had some stupid power-ups.
You really should put an effort into streaming, like your pursuits in Binding of Isaac, because I think a lot of people would like to watch you play. I know I certainly like watching you play. I like watching you play more than I like playing.
I'm like that with some games as well. Yeah, I might at some point. I'm getting toward the end of Rebirth, but then again, the new DLC is coming out, I think, tomorrow.
Oh, wow.
Yeah, the Afterbirth Plus DLC. So, like, I'm gonna try to hold off on getting it until I complete the Keeper, but I don't know if I'll be able to hold that in, number one, and number two. Just playing as the Keeper sucks, so I might want to get the new DLC just to diversify the game a little bit. So we'll see where that goes. So that's Isaac.
I think you need to find specific synergies to help out. Like, I would like to watch you play just to see what kind of synergies you end up liking and doing.
Yeah, with the Keeper, some synergies are freaking stupid. Like, I was able to get, I think I mentioned this last week, but I was able to get Epic Fetus plus Double Shot plus Monstro Lung. So there's just like five targets flying around, and then the rockets come down twice in a row. It's absolutely absurd. And even with, yeah,
that
and
sounds scary.
It's ridiculous. Like, it one shots just about everything. And even with the Keeper's innate triple shot ability, if you get Epic Fetus, it's only a single rocket, but it comes down three times in rapid succession. So if I were ever able to get compound shots on top of that, it would just be the stupidest thing. So that would be kind of
my
nice.
Problem with that game is that I don't know what all the items do. Like, you know what I mean? Like,
well,
I
you find out when you use them.
Things.
Yeah, you find out when you use them.
That's my problem.
And in my case, I go to the wiki to check sometimes, because I think it's very useful. So that's Isaac. Otherwise, I played some Doom, but not Doom 2016. Now that I have a computer that can support it, I finally went back to Doom 3 BFG Edition because I wanted to try out two things. Number one, the additional campaign in Doom 2. By the way, Vice, I remember that with you, you just took the WAD file out of the game and put it onto Steam.
Yep.
Yeah.
Or no, I put it into the Doom 2. I use GZ Doom, I think is what it's called.
Okay.
Or GX Doom.
Doom Launcher. You're right the first time.
Yeah, it's a Doom Launcher.
Z Doom, I think, but yeah.
That basically modernizes Doom and does a few things to allow you to play it in like widescreen and
I don't even care so much about that, but the ability to play Doom properly would have been nice, because if you play Doom 2 through Doom 3, then it's not the same. Like you need to go to the Doom 3 controls to do control customization, because Doom 2 doesn't have it. So I understand even though it's a little obnoxious, but you could set the left or right arrow keys to turn. You could play however you want with WSAD or whatever, but you could basically turn or strafe. Like, I mean, the way I was playing it, I guess you could set still different keys on your keyboard to do it, but I'm used to old Doom where left and right turn left and right, and if you want to strafe, you hold Alt and you press left and right, and that was not an option, and it was just
a weirdo.
That's how everyone played it. That's Doom. And it was just frustrating to play at that point. And you also can't just type in codes. You have to go to, like, the config file and allow the console option to come up and then type those in. And even then, not all of the codes are acceptable. So it wasn't quite classic Doom. I mean, the levels were great, but I would have been better off playing it in, Z Doom or GZ Doom instead of Doom 3. That was a mistake.
Maybe I'll help you fix that up. That way you can play it in Z Doom, because Z Doom makes the experience so much more fun.
Oh, it's great. And the levels were cool as hell, too. For Doom 3, I've beaten Doom 3 before, but this came with a new sort of expansion of levels called the Lost Levels. So there's a part
Mario.
Yeah, exactly like Mario. There's a part in, I think there's a part in Doom 3 where it shows some rando, like, Bravo team.
Doki Doki Doom.
There was an expansion, or there's a part in, like, Doom 3 which shows, like, some, like, randos from Bravo team getting killed off by monsters, and it's like, oh man, this shows you what, how big a problem it is, but I guess you play as one of those members of Bravo team, and you just kind of make your own way through a campaign, and you also go to hell and kill a big monster at the end, and it doesn't really add anything to the narrative, but it's kind of cool to experience Doom 3 again. So it's kind of
like Blue Shift in...
Both
of those are kind of expansions of Half-Life 2. Blue Shift and...
Opposing Force.
Opposing Force, yeah.
Yeah. So, like, I don't know if what you did contributed to the main story, but you did a thing, and it's cool, and you get an experience... Or you get an opportunity to play Doom again, so... That was kind of nice.
Nice.
And that's... pretty much my gaming experience, so I guess I'm nice. Guess I'm all set. Yeah.
Weren't you doing a little bit of a recording for your channel as well?
Yeah, I mean I put this on our show notes, but yeah, I recorded the Q&A video because I'd posted a status update asking people to ask me questions and I would answer them, kind of like we do on the podcast. I recorded that. There was like an error when rendering, so I'm just gonna have to render it again and upload it later. Mm. So hopefully that won't take too terribly long.
Nice. Well, it sounds like you have some projects going on there.
Yeah.
Nice. Minty Mints, would you like to take it away on your segment?
Sure. So yesterday, on Masterpiece, Sherlock Season 4 came out, Episode 1.
I heard that series just keeps getting better.
It's a really good version of Sherlock.
It is. It is a very good version of Sherlock. It takes place in the modern world. Rather than in the past. I don't want to say too much about it, but it definitely has... It's still excellent, but it definitely has, like, a bit of a character development, if you might want to say.
Okay.
On the part of Sherlock. I really do enjoy the series, but it is a lot to take in all at once. I would not suggest binge-watching it. Perhaps maybe that's the best way to actually intake all the information.
Yeah.
It doesn't make you depressed. It's just like look at all these information that he throws into you, and just you have to absorb it all. And can you absorb all that he throws at you?
And then, I'd be up to the challenge.
It's quite difficult, I would say. But it is pretty excellent. Of course, it always leaves some sort of cliffhanger, so it's just like, oh my god, please, episode 2, please come out. And I know it just came out yesterday. Maybe I should have, like, waited, but I just couldn't help myself.
Yeah, one of the cool things about, I think it was season 3 of Sherlock, that was kind of the same as the end of the second movie of Sherlock. They both ended with the scene that Sir Arthur Conan Doyle ended with. At Sherlock, before he thought he was going to continue,
the waterfall.
Where they fall off the waterfall.
Oh yeah.
Sherlock and Moriarty both fall off a waterfall, and that's how it ends. And you're not sure if they both die, if any of them survive. Yeah. So the end of the second movie and the end of, I believe it was season 3 of the show, both ended similar to that.
Yes.
Which is really cool that they kept that theme when they didn't know they were going to continue.
Nice.
Yes, Yeah, those type of cliffhangers is just like, it's like, oh my god, please, more. So I guess they catered a little to continue.
I can't believe that Benedict Cumberbatch and Martin Freeman are still doing that show, because like they are like really big time movie stars now, like both of them. Like Martin Freeman really like has a lot of really cool stuff going on. I mean, he was in Fargo, and he you
I,
know
I
he
think
has,
he,
oh,
I
of
think
course
he
was
narrated.
Bilbo.
I think he narrated, like, some of the, starting from number 2, he narrated, like, the, what is it, Hitchhiker's Guide to the Galaxy.
Oh, neat.
So I actually
Because he was in the movie.
Was he in the movie?
He was in the more modern
The most
F
one?
Movie. Yeah.
Yeah, wow, neat.
Yeah, so book 1, 2, 3, 4, 5. Anyways,
what,
most,
a Hitchhiker's Guide?
Yeah, I listen to the
audiobooks. Oh, he did the voice audiobooks. Oh, yeah. Okay. I didn't realize that.
So he
okay.
narrates the whole entire book and everything.
Oh, that's great. I'm sure I would enjoy that. I've read the books before. I've read all five of them, or all five of the original ones, and I would definitely like to listen to them in the car every once in a while.
Yeah, most like it's really excellent. Like sometimes he says things, and you're like, what's going on in this book? And then it just continues that in that route of like bewilderment, and then it's like semi cringe in a sense, mm-hmm. of what the characters are doing.
That's awesome.
So that's in terms really of cool. gaming these days, in terms of gaming, I've been continuing playing Dark Souls 3. I was gonna ask you guys that if you guys were interested, if you guys do continue the Dark Souls game, you guys would be interested in like multiplayer, because it seems that the multiplayer these days are actually pretty good. I could like set up like a server or something like that and put a password on it.
Do you play it on PC?
I do not. I play it on the PS4.
I play on PC.
I play on PC as well.
I play on PS4, but I don't play or pay for PS Plus, so multiplayer isn't an option for me.
Oh, do you have... Oh, I forgot.
Yeah. Yeah, for PlayStation and for Xbox, you need to pay for the Plus or Gold option to go online.
Oh, I see. Well, these days I have been only... I played Dark Souls mostly offline. I don't do a lot of the invasions or get invaded in a sense, so I actually don't mm-hmm. know too much about the multiplayer system in that sense.
I played a little bit with Luminaire on Bloodborne, and that was pretty fun, but the... getting it to sync up right is kind of like those games don't exactly have a lobby or anything, so like you have to do it in their arcane way of like summoning your friends. It's kind of weird. You have to do it with bells, I think, in Bloodborne. I think I would really like to play it multiplayer at least a little bit as I get going, but I don't have Dark Souls 3 yet. I have the other games in the series. I have Dark Souls 1 and 2 and Demon Souls and Bloodborne, but mm-hmm. I've actually made a resolution of sorts, maybe not a New Year's resolution. I started doing this a little while ago. I've stopped buying sequels to games that I haven't finished like the first one of.
No.
So like I have this problem where I have every single game in the series and I haven't played any of them. So like for instance, I have every Shin Megami Tensei game that has ever been released in English, and I haven't beaten any of them.
So the reason I got into Dark Souls was because I went to France. There was a convention going on, I think in Montreal something. And I played Bloodborne like when it came out as like a demoing kind of when they had the PS4 demos area going on, and I really liked it. So of course I couldn't afford to buy a PS4 or that at the time, so next best thing was who are the makers of this series, and then it went
from
Souls.
Software. Yeah,
from Software. So I went to Dark Souls, and then that's how I just started. And
nice.
Started going into the series, but I wouldn't call myself like a hardcore person.
What's your favorite so far out of the series?
I did like Dark Souls 1. I haven't played Dark Souls 2. I'm not really sure why I skipped it. But then I jumped straight into Dark Souls 3 because.
It's what came out at the time, and you felt like playing it, I bet.
Yes. And I really did like the gameplay. It's like it doesn't use too much, like it relies on so heavily on like the actions and placement of characters and items and everything that's in the game, like placement and the way they say things, hidden messages are very important. So to piece together the story, of course there's like the vague story that's going on in the game, but you as a player have to piece together the story in order to find out what really is going on. And when you discover what's beneath the tip of the iceberg, it's like, oh my god, so this could have happened, this could have possibly happened, oh, this is what it might have implied. I don't want to go too deep into Dark Souls because it's just that the whole, there's so much lore behind it, there's so much details behind it, so many arguments, counter arguments between like the very hardcore players who actually like data mine to get like
bits of lore,
and like unused dialogue in the game. Is just a whole bunch of things that it's just can't be covered in just basically talking about like one part of the storyline, etc. Mm-hmm.
Yeah, I really like that about the games too.
Yeah, I like these kinds of games. I mean, I like when there's some ambiguity to things. I wish more movies would have ambiguous things, so you have to think a little bit about mm-hmm. what's going on. These days, I think a lot of movies are very straightforward and don't have like a lot of substance.
Mm-hmm.
Like you occasionally get you know some really good ones, but. For instance, like the Marvel movies and the Star Wars movies, even though mm-hmm. I like watching them, they're good, great popcorn flicks. They don't really have any subtleness to them at all, and that's something I miss. You know, there's some really great film directors that do have some subtlety, but I feel like it gets stripped out a lot by corporate filmmaking, unfortunately.
Mm. I do enjoy the occasional, like, I do read a lot of mangas and such. In a sense, I do understand what you mean, because you're more observant of the movies than I would be. Like, I do enjoy, like, when, let's say, manga artists take the time to put something that's happening in the background, but it's not part of the main dialogue. But if you go back to see what's happening in the background, you piece together a bit more of the story than just simply reading the main dialogue.
Sure.
I think you could say One Piece does this very, 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 very often.
Hmm.
I didn't
think about it like that.
If you read One Piece, like, I know Oda, he does, has, like, a lot of stuff going on in the background. If you look closely at, like, what the characters or what images are in the background, it does paste together maybe as a foresight, hindsight, or whichever one you want to call it.
Foreshadowing.
Oops. Yeah, there we go. some sort of foreshadowing towards the story. Well, okay, the next thing is, I'm going to talk about some party games that I tend to play with my cousins a lot. This game is like, it's not really a necessary game. Everybody who has a phone and a connection to the internet can do it. It's called Jackbox. Have you guys heard of it?
Yep.
Oh, yeah, we talked about it the last couple episodes.
Oh, mm-hmm. Oops. It shows that I haven't been listening to it properly. but
Terrible.
Terrible? Oh, no.
Yeah. Yeah, you haven't kept up with the continuity. You're spoiling the story for yourself.
Oh, no, it's now that I found out. Anyways, I did enjoy Jackbox a lot with my cousin, so this is, like, one of those party games of, like, we're out in the middle of nowhere. And there's a TV, and there's internet. It's all good.
Nice. I like Jackbox a lot. I think I'm going to try to get our friends to play it while we're down there at MAGFest, because it's just a great game, you know, great collection of games, rather. I think it's always something that you could waste some good time with. Yeah.
Okay. I know that, like, there's, like, the free version, and then there's, like, the if you pay in the Steam version, there's like a whole bunch of other crazy games as well. So
yeah, there's a lot to it. I know that some of the Jackboxes have expansions kind of to them, where you can buy like extra games for them.
Okay. So you know, I have a discussion about going to MAGFest. I might. Well, I think I am. I'm running way behind schedule, as like I think us all cosplayers can understand.
Yeah, all cosplayers have a crunch at the end.
Oh my god!
For sure.
Yeah, I need to finish up stuff tomorrow.
Oh my god! I'm not necessarily a serious cosplayer. I guess you can call me. I can be called a casual cosplayer. I cosplay whenever I feel like. I'm gonna cosplay as Rise as. From Persona 4.
Oh, neat.
I had trouble putting the last stitches together on the outfit. I just don't know how to do it properly. So it's most of these things I do improvisations by myself. Like I just think that I think it can be done this way and just do it instead of actually looking it up sometimes online where other people might have methods. But usually when I go to message board discussions, they just say, oh, I just stitched this up all by myself with very little detail on how they actually stitch it up. So I just went and did it on my own, what I think they might have done. In terms of cosplaying, like, sometimes I feel like if you buy, like, a costume online, either or, I would say make your own or buy online. Buying online is cheaper in a sense, you know, there's somebody who already made the cosplay for you, they asked for your measurements, and everything's done. Mm-hmm. But when you're doing it by yourself, you run into all of these little technical details that, you know, you would not have never known unless, you know, you made the costume yourself. It's like a satisfaction in a sort of way, but without the you see the hard work that gets put into making a cosplay is what mm-hmm. it is. When I was looking for supplies, like sometimes I couldn't find let's say the pattern that I like or the textile with that pattern, sometimes the material doesn't feel right or doesn't look right in the light. You have to, as a person who needs to find a correct textile, you have to be able to see, like,
yeah, maybe this movie filmmaking is a lot like that too. You have to pay attention to the texture of things.
Oh yeah, the texture and all that lighting is like very important. But before you get all this textile and understanding the textile and like what cloth best reflects what costume you like to make, you also have to make sure you actually have the supplies. So as mm-hmm. a person who might start out cosplaying, they might find themselves like having to buy all sorts of things that they would never have like thought of before. Like obviously you want like a sewing machine, but besides a sewing machine, you might need to like get specific threads. And first time people who might encounter this might see a lot of snagging when they sew on their machine because they're not using the correct thread for the type of cloth they're using on. So now something like that is it might not seem as obvious as like, oh, I just find a thread and I have a sewing machine and I can sew a straight line, cool beans, and then they have the specific material that they're using and then it snags and they don't know why, things like that. And
yeah, this is tangentially related, but yeah. I had kind of a similar experience with I've been wanting to do some repairs to my consoles and things like that and mods, and I think I would have the skill to do it, but I just don't have any of the tools. I don't have like all the different things I need to buy for soldering and things like that. So I'm kind of running into the same kind of issues that you are, but for sewing.
In terms of like I would say like whenever I hear you make like redo some materialing, I feel like you do need like the different point levels of soldering tools. Like, I know how to say it, like there are different like 0.5 or you know the thickness of the soldering tool, and then you need the tool that sucks up the soldering ball or something.
Need a desoldering pump and you need like all kinds of different things, and like it's really hard to find out like what you need for your specific job, because like there are certain jobs in which thinner solder will be better or thicker solder, or flux will be good for you or flux won't be good for you, things like that. And also you can spend any amount of dollars really on what you're doing. You can buy really high-end stuff, or you can buy really cheap stuff, and the cheap stuff's no good. It's kind of hard to find a medium.
I think the general rule is if you're planning on using this one item for a very long time, it's best to spend just a little bit extra money. You know how your discussion went with your computer
building. Yeah, it doesn't need to be the Rolls Royce, but you should buy decent stuff.
Yes, yes.
Because you want it to be easy. Like, the cheaper it is, the harder it's going to be for you. And when you have low amount of skill, it makes it even that much harder for you. For instance, like, if you buy, like, a really cheap soldering iron and you don't know how to solder well and you're trying to learn, the cheap soldering iron actually inhibits your learning and can discourage you.
Yes.
Which is no good. So that's something that I learned when I was going through high school and early college, is that I had a really bad soldering iron, and that's actually why I got so discouraged with it. It was I had the wrong tools for what I was trying to do at the time.
In the beginning, I remember I was when I was cutting cloth specifically, I used like a regular pair of scissors that was like cutting paper and stuff for cutting papers, and I think my mom yelled at me. She was like, "What are you using that scissor for? That doesn't work." And she brought out her pair of cloth cutting scissors. That's like, there are scissors specifically for cutting cloth, and you can never use it for anything else ever, type of thing.
Sure.
So she has a scissor specifically for cutting cloth. Apparently, that if you use like scissors for like paper, it actually dulls the scissor blades. I mean, you can always sharpen them back, but it's like to prevent
in
such
the
a
ass.
Yeah. In the end, yeah. But in the end, I guess like your sewing machine. I know it might be an expensive item to get. You could get a fairly cheap sewing machine, and it still works properly. But the pair of scissors you're gonna be using, that you are always gonna need a pair of scissors. So that is a item that is definitely worth the investment. Just to say, in terms of starting out.
Gotcha.
So it seems like the sewing machine is important, but you could like change that up, upgrade that later on. But that pair of scissors, like, you want your experience to start off right. That scissors is like the important thing.
Yeah, I
sewing
agree.
Needles,
and
things like that.
Sewing machines also come in a lot of different kinds of varieties. There's also like portable ones and non-portable ones, and like all kinds of different ones. You can have ones that like have programs that you can program, you know, like from your computer. Like, there's like all different kinds of ones that you could get, right?
Yep. The current ones I left with my sister is like they're all portable. They're relatively cheap, so it's like under like $90 or something like that. Left that with my sister, but the current one I have is like about $200-something. And it doesn't have all those programmable things that people say. It does. I feel like in terms of normal cosplay, I haven't been able to utilize like the 100 patterns that they come computerize and stuff like that. Maybe I'm too old-fashioned or something. But at the moment, the simple machine is really what you need to get started until you know that you're doing like quilting and everything.
One thing I found that about sewing is that you gotta watch your hand when you use a sewing machine. It's just a tip.
No, you really do.
You gotta make sure that you don't get caught between the fibers.
Well, if you look at the sewing machine, the part where the needle goes up and down at, that there's a thing. It looks kind of like a foot. I think we call it a foot. So,
yeah.
That foot is actually very important. There's a standard foot, there are foots for like zippers, there's a foot for button making, there's a walking foot. Walking foot is like for thicker materials and etc. Those are like, sometimes it's extremely important to have the correct foot. But I think that foot is supposed to help guide the cloth, as well as for your fingers to not go past the point where the needle is going up and down.
That's actually one of the things that like has always scared me about woodworking. Like,
yeah, the
I've always
bandsaw.
Wanted to do my own woodworking. It follows the same kind of it has the same kind of feeling, right? You know, you're inserting the wood similar to the way you would insert cloth into that kind of thing, and you just have to. I mean, it's all about practice, right? It's all about doing it and finding a way to be comfortable and also be safe.
How do you say it? I would say woodworking is definitely more dangerous because you have a really, really long blade that's going really, really fast. I think your fingers can fall off if you get cut versus that if you got your finger caught in a sewing machine, you got stabbed.
Sure. And that wouldn't be fun either.
None of these situations or scenarios are fun, but I think what working has is danger that is.
Well, even people that like do it a lot still can mess up.
Arguably, especially people who do it a lot, because you know amateurs are going to be more cautious because they're terrified. You know, when you get used to it, that's where you can start having problems.
So that's kind of what stopped me from doing it. But I think it's a valuable skill, and you can also save a lot of money by doing it yourself. So like I've been wanting to make my own arcade stick boxes.
Oh, you should.
And I want to make them out of really nice wood.
Oh, then invest in like a Dremel that you'll like. A quick handheld Dremel will take you far, and like you know a little small woodworks and et cetera.
I'll probably still need a circular saw in order to make like the big pieces. You know what I mean? Dremel's for like small stuff generally, right?
Yeah.
Go to your local high school and ask if they'll let you use it.
You know, from a guy who has half a thumb missing.
Yeah.
Oh my god. I think I'm not really sure how schools work these days, but like there are some places in the city, country, wherever suburbs are. If you look it up, there are people that actually host little tiny workshops
that
allow you to use their tools for a small fee or something like that. So,
well, I actually do have a really good friend who has a lot of those tools. But I want to learn how to use them, so I have a good resource in that regard. So I'll probably utilize him. But the problem is I want to use really good wood, and I hear that's not what you should be starting off with. You should make something crummy first, you know, like something that you can mess up on, and won't cost as much. Like you work with a soft wood like pine before you work with like a hard wood like walnut or cherry or something like that.
Man, you went for the hardcore stuff. I was gonna say try some balsa wood first, and then go from there. But
well, like, I think wood balsa from, like, wood
Home Depot or something.
Balsa wood is so thin, though. Like, I don't think I want to use balsa wood yet, but because like it's not real enough of an experience, I think. But I think pine will be fine.
Okay.
If I made it a first project that was a pine joystick box, I think that would be really neat. And then I'll make a really nice looking cherry one, or maybe I'll just like stain the pine one until it looks really good, like it was cherry or something like that. So who knows? But that's new territory for me, and I'm always working on projects anyway. And I should be working on getting corrective consciousness off the ground rather than woodworking.
Well, it's all good. It's all good. It's good to have little hobbies. I feel like I'm a person that's like I self-proclaim that I'm like a jack of all trades, but still, that second part of that is master of none. So,
I think we're all like that. Like our group of friends is great because we have like a lot of varied interests. Like we like a lot of different things, and we're experts at a lot of different things, I think. Yeah. Anything that we get into, we get into it like all the way. So I think that's what's really cool about our group of friends, and that's what I think makes the podcast fun to listen to. It's like, you know, we're all into, we're all very passionate about what we like. So, that's just my take on it.
Okay. I'm done with talking about cosplay. It's just like a whole list of things that, we can all go into. But in the meantime, we can start with like supplies and textiles. And if I get invited back next time, I can tell you more about little other details too.
Well, I think I'm planning on doing even like a bonus episode for while we're at MAGFest, recording a bonus episode a bunch of us there. Pretty much almost all of the guests will be there, except for maybe Stephanie. It'll be cool to have us all in one room.
Mm-hmm. Oh man.
I'm going to bring my laptop and we'll have a good time. Yeah. So, did you have anything else that you wanted to go over?
I'm good for now.
All right. Thanks for that, Minty Mints. Mm-hmm. I will go next. Going into kind of what I was alluding to before, I've been having severe issues with my Neo Geo home system. So it was a freebie, so I'm not like really heard about it, you know, that kind of thing. But it needs a bunch of repairs before it's going to be usable. I replaced the BIOS chip with the custom BIOS that people make online, and it turns out the system not only needs a new headphone jack, but it also needs new cartridge ports. Like, it wasn't playing a game correctly. And it needed a new power switch, because my power switch broke. Did I tell you guys about this?
I don't think so.
Okay, so I noticed something funny about the power switch. Like, the texture was kind of off. Like, it wasn't like the rest of the plastic of the system. And turns out it was a 3D printed power switch. And so it was a replacement by whoever had the system before me. So it came from a friend of the friend who gave it to me. So this 3D printed switch wasn't made well, and it fell apart.
Oh, no.
So I needed a power switch too on top of it, a new power switch. So what I ended up doing is, actually there was a person who was making 3D printed power switches for this thing, a different person, and the design is much, much better than the one that I got with the system. So I was a little worried about it before I ordered it, because, like, this is basically the only way that I'm going to be able to get a power switch for the system. Like, there are no spare ones lying around very easily.
Is it like a specific shape that you can't just...
Yeah. So it's like a piece of plastic that interfaces with the switch in the actual system itself inside. So it needs to be, I need to have that piece of plastic in order to use my thumb in order to turn on the system, you know.
Okay.
And so the original one's missing, and you know, the replacement that came with it fell apart, and it was like blue plastic that had been like painted black, so it looked kind of crummy too. So I took a picture of this after I had ordered the 3D printed one from the guy who is currently making it, and he showed me how his design is a lot better than the design of the person that had made the original one. So the person who had made the original one had actually copied the design of the original switch, and you think that would be good, but that's based off of injected plastic and how it holds up to certain types of stress.
Mm-hmm.
So 3D printed plastic has different strengths and weaknesses compared to injected plastic. So therefore, it can't be built the same if it's going to not fall apart. And he designed his specifically in a way in which it wouldn't fall apart under the stresses of basically switching the system on and off causes structural stress on the plastic. And so eventually, you know, the original one that I got, the original 3D printed one that I had, was bound to fall apart at any moment because it's just not the right type of plastic for the design that that was made. So the person who did it did a good job at copying the shape, but didn't take the structural integrity into account. And we had a really good discussion over Facebook. The guy's a really nice guy. I'm actually going to do a plug for him. He runs a store called Three Lions online that also prints other 3D printed stuff for like arcade cabinets and consoles and things like that. So he has universally great reviews from people on the Neo Geo forums. So I was glad to talk to him, and he's a hell of a nice guy. He said, if it breaks, please let me know. So first of all, so I can improve the design, but also so I can give you another one. So I thought that was a stand-up like way of taking that. Like, he's like, if it falls apart, I don't want to ship this to anybody else. Like, I want to make a good one.
Mm-hmm.
So I thought that was like a really fantastic way to react to that. He didn't get really defensive. He was just worried that he was sending out bad stuff. So he asked me for a picture of the one that I had to make sure that it wasn't his, and also how his design was better. So it was really neat. And I got actually two of those in the mail, just in case you know, just so I have another one. They weren't that expensive, you know, it was 3D printed, so it wasn't that bad. So I'm about to send the system to get all of that rehab done from the modder that I use. And hopefully by the end of it, I'll have a really great, you know, a Neo Geo home system. I'm also still waiting for my my consoleized arcade Neo Geo called the Omega. So apparently the Arcade Works is having a really hard time with their postal service. They had like a really bad issue and they're trying to resolve it with them right now. I talked to him and the guy was really nice, but it seems like they're still having issues combined with the fact that it's been like, you know, wall-to-wall holidays here. So I'm sure things haven't been getting done very quickly.
Mm-hmm.
So on anybody's ends. So hopefully I'll get that maybe this week. I hope that's what happens. And I get that all fixed up, and that way I have a full entertainment center working again.
Nice.
So I bought only a couple things this week, which is good for me. I usually buy a bunch of things, and I took a lot of thought into what I was buying every time I bought something, because I feel like I spend too much. I certainly haven't spent enough to the point where it puts me in danger or anything like that. It's just that I think I should have a little bit more cushion for my position, because I'm going to be buying a house hopefully sometime soon.
Mm-hmm.
And I want to be able to have as much money as I can off towards the side. So I bought Glitter Mitten Grove. So
yeah.
I don't know if you guys have heard about
yep.
this, but it is a game that was put out by Adult Swim Games, and apparently it is secretly Frog Fractions 2.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, it's amazing.
Glitter Mitten Grove is actually its own game. So it's like this simulator. It's like a management simulator, like a resource management simulator. And it's apparently pretty fun on its own, but hidden within the game is Frog Fractions 2, and they told people in the Kickstarter that it wouldn't be called Frog Fractions 2.
Yeah.
So, and what's even funnier is when you get to the credits of Frog Fractions 2, it says it's Frog Fractions 3.
nice.
So it actually isn't called Frog Fractions 2, but it is.
I love how incredibly obnoxious that is.
Yeah, and also people had to, like, play it on obnoxious, like alternate reality game. They had to play, like, an ARG in order to get the game released. Like, the guys probably had the game done for a long time, or at least a while. They've been playing this ARG for 2 years straight, I think, and like some really interesting stuff. I encourage people to watch like a YouTube video explaining the gist of it. But the guy who makes Frog Fractions basically has been putting out cryptic clues on how to unlock the game for a really long time.
Mm-hmm.
And one of them was like incredibly cryptic. I forget all the different steps to get to it, but it was like all this crazy stuff. And then eventually they found this like GBA ROM, like a Game Boy Advance ROM, that when you play it in an emulator, it looks like it's a Castlevania ROM. Like it's Castlevania, like Aria of Sorrow. And then it turns out that it just like fools you after the after like the introduction, and it just says Frog Fractions 2 isn't being released. it's just like really obnoxious stuff. Like people, it's like, no, it's not happening. I'm canceling it. Like constantly. And so the final steps in this was that like somebody played an Escape the Room game that the Frog Fractions guy held. It was like in California or something. And the winner got a key. And then there was some other contest that somebody won, and they got, like, a locked box sent to them.
Oh, God, really? And they had to, like, meet each other somehow?
Oh, my God.
Yeah, they had to meet up. And then so what it turns out is it was kind of like a nuclear, like, launch button. It was, like, a lock that you had to lock and then press the button. And it was like, and then what happened was that unlocked a video being posted on YouTube by the Frog Fractions guy, and it was basically like a like real footage from a like a NASA thing of two things docking in space. It was like real footage, and it was like really long, and nothing happens other than these things docking. And he's like, okay, I released it. And people are like, okay, where is it? And he's just like, you have to find it. So eventually, like, some instructions got released in some other, like, bunch of like, clues that were released. And they found out that it was in this Adult Swim game, like, hidden in this Adult Swim game in two different spots. And then people finally unlocked it. But that game was released like half a month ago,
mm-hmm.
like before it finally got found out. So the game had been out, and it was in people's people owned it, but they didn't know it.
If anything, this makes me happy because of all the information that gets leaked for games sometimes, or how soon before they'll start talking about a game before it's even out. Like, I'm glad that we can see that people can hold their shit together like this.
Yeah.
What was really great about it was that a lot of the clues were actually found in other indie games, like Friends mm-hmm. of the Guy.
That is ridiculous.
So, like, a lot of the clues that people were placing together, they actually had to buy other games and try other people's games in order to find them. So it was really neat. Really, really cool stuff. Just, like, the whole story of it. I would have found it probably really frustrating if I was piecing it all together myself. But it's a great story, and it's really funny that he released the game to negative publicity. Like, almost, like, it's just, like the absence, the total absence of publicity for a game that people really wanted to play. It's like, and it fits the game too. It's not like oh, you get a game that has like nothing to do with this kind of humor. Like the whole thing surrounding it, it seems like it's part of the game. You know what I mean? So it was pretty cool. And there's a really simple way to unlock Frog Fractions too. And I hope Lotus and I run through the first one in some kind of let's play,
yeah,
and then
too
play
good.
That one, because it was like, it blew my mind when I played that game.
Number of fruits
the first time.
Like a billion.
Like a billion.
Like a billion.
So if anybody doesn't know, Frog, I didn't explain this. Frog Fractions was a game that was like a Flash game that was released online, and it looks like it's going to be a parody of or at least a math game from like when we were kids, like Number Munchers or something. But it has math in it, but none of it makes any sense.
It doesn't matter.
You earn fractions. Like,
yeah, like you're not actually doing any math. Like you eat stuff and it's like 3/4, but for nothing. It just says fractions, and eventually it starts getting into like scientific notation. It's like you ate like 6 like e to the 7th. It's like what?
And then eventually, like, and you're doing this like basically like any phone game out there. Like you're eating these bugs in order to like get better equipment, and then you get better equipment and you keep going, and then you get all of the equipment except for this one last thing that's way too expensive for anything. And then you start fucking around, and you're like, oh, what am I supposed to do here? And you find out you could have almost the entire time swam below your lily pad,
yeah,
to where all of these like fruits had been dropping. Like, you're supposed to be collecting these fruits, and that's like one of the currencies. And you go down there, and there's like a billion fruit.
Yeah,
at
quote
the bottom
like
of
a billion. Also, the other currency is Zorkmids from like Zork, one of the first games ever made, like electronic games.
So, you collect these fruit, and then all of a sudden you can blast off into space, and it turns into a completely different game that's kind of like a parody of Star Fox.
Yeah, I mean, more into later, like, don't give too much of it away, but it's too good.
But yeah, it changes genres constantly, and it is literally one of the funniest things I've ever experienced in my life. It's up there with Barkley Shop and Jim Gaiden. It's
yeah, the writing incredibly clever. Both of those is just like, wow, how do they do it?
Yeah, it also the boxing segment, I'm not even going to tell you what that means, but yeah. The boxing segment is one of my favorite things of all time. It's really great. But I can't wait to play that. I mean, I have it, but I really want to play it with Lotus because, like, that's just right up our alley. Other than that, I did buy a single table in Stern Pinball Arcade. So I bought AC/DC, which was really neat. It's supposed to be like the flagship pinball table in that particular game. So they patched it and the game works now. It's still glitchy as hell, but it at least works, you know? So I'm excited about that. And let me see here. I played a little bit of Job Simulator because my friends were playing PSVR at their house, and that's always a good time. And I read something really cool. I have long been a member of the Hardcore Gaming 101's forums and part of its community and friends with a lot of people on there. And I've done quite a few of the podcasts with them. And the owner of the website, who's a personal friend of mine, his name's Kurt Collada. He has been actually extremely prolific in putting out books in the last few years. I know Lotus buys them.
Oh, yeah. They're really, really good.
They're the best of their kind. They explain games in better detail and in better way, in the best looking way too. They're extremely attractive when you look at them. The colors, the layout. He puts in a lot of effort into making them readable and extremely informative and well researched. I can't think of anybody like he's my friend, but. Also, like he's the best at it that I know.
Yeah,
of.
For real.
He's really good at it, and he made a Konami shoot 'em up one that had Twinbee, Parodius, and Gradius, and all the spin-offs of those. But he made one on shoot 'em ups in general recently, and he also made a couple other books. His Sega Arcade Classics Volume 2 and Sonic.
I'm so happy about that. I was waiting for Volume 2 like ever since Volume 1 came out.
Yeah, and he, you know what, he didn't take all that long to do it. He's been constantly putting out books. He did a Data East one and a Taito one not too long ago.
Data East was nuts. I mean, like, the Taito book was great, don't get me wrong, but like, I'm just fascinated by just the batshit craziness that is Data East.
Yeah, I mean, he's been so good at putting these books out, and very quickly. He puts out like 3 or 4 a year.
Considering how comprehensive they are, like, that's a lot.
Yeah, there are tons of articles in there, and they are extremely good at recommending which versions of which games to play, and every single version is covered. Of every one of those games. So I got to relive some of my love for compile shmups, which includes Zanuck and Gunnak and Guardian Legend and the Musha and Elist games and Space Megaforce. There are quite a few awesome shmups made by Compile. They also made Puyo Puyo. In case anybody doesn't know who they are. And also the Star Soldier games are in there as well, which are made by Hudson. And those are some of my favorite... those are my favorite games that are on the PC Engine or the TurboGrafx. So they're a fantastic resource for all of those games, and I can't wait for the next guide to come out, which will probably have a lot of cave games in it, if I know them well.
Nice.
So, I also finished Breaking Bad after watching it
awesome.
For
I
the last 3 years.
Same here.
It is very, very worth it. It gets a lot of high praise, and it deserves it. It is a fantastic story about. I'm not even giving you spoilers here. It's a fantastic story about how a good man becomes a terrible man.
Mm-hmm.
I guess riffs off of Godfather in a way, because that's the story of Godfather, the Godfather, but it does it really well in a modern context and in a completely different way.
Mm.
You had a son that was brought into his family's crime drama in The Godfather, and then he, in an attempt to keep his family together, he destroys his family
mm-hmm.
and ends up being alone. Breaking Bad is more about survival, I guess, because he gets cancer at the beginning of the show. That's the conceit of the show, so there's not a spoiler, really. But he's trying to survive, and this is what he thinks of to do to survive, and this is how he chooses to live after being confronted with death. And is that any life at all? Like, really, it makes you think. It's like what he goes through, it might be way worse than what would have happened if he had died. So it ends in such a really great, satisfying way. It wraps up a lot of the everything in a nice little bow. It's really cool.
Sure.
So I definitely recommend it to our listeners here if you haven't watched it yet. I'm going to watch Better Call Saul soon as well, which is the spinoff show. It's a prequel show.
Mm-hmm.
There's 2 seasons of that so far. So, other than that, I have my way in. I am exactly the same, which is good, which means I will start losing weight. I bet you when I come back next time, I will have lost a bunch of weight because I have stuck to eating well for the past 3 days.
Nice.
So, I'm really committed this time around, and I started going back to the gym again after falling off from the holidays. So, I'm excited, and I think this is going to be a year of vast improvement in a lot of ways for me this year.
Mm.
So, not that I was really slumming it, but I'm always a person that's working on himself, and I feel really good lately.
Oh, that's good.
Oh, if you do find yourself gaining weight because you've been going to the gym, I would not worry about it. I think you're supposed to gain quite a bit of weight. Well, not like a lot, but gain some weight before you actually lose it again. I think, like, I hope you won't get discouraged if you see that when you're going to the gym, you're kind of gaining, like, some muscle weight.
Oh, sure.
And then, I would not say, don't look too deeply into how much you are weighing once you start working out a little more hardcore.
Well, here's the way I view it, is that for my height, my weight is, I'm at 228, is too much.
Yeah.
And even though I will be gaining muscle, I still want to lose weight on top of that. It's too much. So if I was at 200 or just below it, I would be very, very happy.
Okay.
So I don't think there's anything wrong with that. But I do agree with you that weight is not the only measure of success in becoming healthy. But it is definitely something that needs to happen for me in particular.
Okay.
So I won't get discouraged because I've been working at this for a little while. But I feel very good in my head about things, and also about progressing. And I'm also going to be living on my own soon, which means I'll have like complete control over my meals.
That's which not as good as it sounds.
No, it's better for me. When I lived on my own back during college, and I was in my apartment, I was extremely good at keeping myself on task.
Mm.
The only things that I made were super healthy things. And you folks know that my dad is an amazing Italian cook, and he makes really great food, and not that I don't appreciate it, and not that I don't love it. I just love it a little too much. And like, the stuff he makes is really great quality. Like, it's not like it's full of preservatives and stuff like that. But it also has calories.
Mm-hmm.
I definitely want to be the kind of guy that eats a lot of like grilled chicken, which is what I used to do back in college.
Tupperware.
Yeah. I'm going to make a lot of my meals ahead of time, like 2-3 days ahead of time,
mm-hmm.
And just heat it up. And I used to eat steamed vegetables and a different version of grilled chicken almost every day. And then on the weekends, I did whatever else I wanted. And every once in a while, I would mix it up, of course. But it was more so I could lose weight back then, and it did help me lose weight. I lost like 100 pounds doing that.
Nice.
So way back then, I got down to 145. I was at like around 240 back then. So I think I can do it, especially if I live by myself.
You can.
So
you have this positivity in your head already, so we think you can do it.
Yeah, I mean, around this Christmas time, I just had a lot of positive things happen, and I've gotten really motivated to do some of the things that I've been wanting to do. So I think things will be really good this year because of it. So having said that, I want to thank everybody for their help in getting through it and their support. So having said that, we can move on to questions.
Yeah, we probably have time for maybe two. First one is from Thakafon. I know he was the last person last time, but after a while, he was like, okay, I got another question, and it turned out that he was the next person anyway. Although the good news is we do have a lot more questions now. But so his was, how important do you think graphics and aesthetics are in video games? I used to think they weren't important, but man, have I changed my mind now. There's a follow-up to this, but we'll start with this one. Graphics and aesthetics, how important are they? Personally, I feel that if you're going for a certain style, it matters. I don't care if it's 8-bit or if it's HD or whatever, but what I care about is if you accomplish what you're trying to do. You know, like, the same games with the same kinds of engines can have very different looking effects. Like, for example, look at Uncharted 1. And then look at Uncharted 2. You know, they're both made by the same game on the same system, but Uncharted 2 definitely looks better because they got better at handling the graphics engine or whatever it is they were using to make the game. Not that Uncharted 1 is like, oh, now it's bad because its graphics aren't as good, but like, if you accomplish what you're trying to do, pretty much, then I'm happy. You know, Killer 7 is all cel-shaded and looks like a comic book, but it looks gorgeous. Not that it's trying to push the GameCube to its limits, but it looks amazing for what it's doing. So that's kind of how I feel about it. Like, that's why all these pixel art games look great now.
I couldn't agree more. So it's all about looking good, not necessarily the HDR-ness of it, you know, or how many pixels are in things or how many polygons are in things. It's all how it looks. As a whole, and whether it accomplishes what you want somebody to feel when they're looking at your work.
Yeah, I think if it matches the art style, like the style or theme of the game, because there are times when pixel games, most people don't like pixel games, let's say, but it could look really good pixel. And I'm not talking about like hand-drawn, like a fighting game, like like Persona 4 Arena, let's say, but even really, really pixelated games can look great if that's the style of the game.
Yeah, so like, for instance, I played Westerado a little while ago, and that's a fantastic pixel game, and a few of the environments look quite amazing. And same thing with Hyper Light Drifter. That's a beautiful mm-hmm. game.
Yeah, absolutely.
Oh, go ahead.
So, actually, I was going to say this ties into the follow-up question, which is just, what games are your favorite visually.
I mean, geez.
There's a lot to work
Ico
with
and
here.
Shadow of the Colossus. I haven't played Last Guardians quite yet, so I can't.
Yeah, but that aesthetic is great.
Uncharted 4.
El Shaddai, Ascension of the Metatron. I'm not even a big fan of the game, but the visuals are freaking nuts.
The last two Tomb Raider games have looked fantastic.
Mm-hmm. Lollipop
I'm
Chainsaw, it's all sparkles and rainbows.
Yeah, I mean, for me, it's Persona 5. I haven't played it yet, but by God.
If I can compare the difference between Dark Souls 1 and Dark Souls 3, there is a definite comparable difference in the graphics, but I feel like there are a few parts of the graphics where it's like well-placed aesthetics that really like in Dark Souls 1, your map is very connected, interconnected. You can walk to anywhere you want, and if you look far enough, you can see the. They give you binoculars in the game. You could look if you look at a specific part of the bridge or higher or above. You can actually see where you might be on in terms of the 3D interactive.
Yeah, Dark Souls 1 is really good at that too.
Rez.
Oh, that's of course. And Child of Eden, similarly. Mm-hmm. And
oh, yeah. Child of Eden, if you play that in 3D mode, oh my god, that game is like.
Sensory overload. Oh, and you know what? This may come as a bit of a surprise. And you can argue it might be a little more creative design than pure visuals. But Dante's Inferno, like, you see some sights in that game.
I need to play that.
Cerberus. It's mediocre. It's a God of War clone. But just for the spectacle of the thing, like, speaking of spectacle, actually, the God of War games, like, it is crazy what those games do with perspective. Even the PS2 ones.
You know, there are lots of games. I'm just trying to think,
like super
Castlevania
hot, very stylized.
3, or Castlevania 4 and Castlevania 3 both look fantastic.
Yeah, in their own ways.
Respective systems.
Mm-hmm.
They just make you feel a certain way when you play them. Their aesthetics, you know, that you're just it's all about the care that's put into how the game
actually
looks.
A whole lot of bullet hells, because they rely mostly on their visuals, because all you're doing is shooting. You'd better be playing something that looks good when you're doing it.
Yeah, I mean, Ikaruga.
Yeah,
looks, especially that final level, looks fan freaking tastic. Mm-hmm.
And Geometry
really,
Wars.
Really yeah, I mean, that in fact inspired tons of other games to look like that that, because it completely brought that kind of style into that vector style into mainstream.
Actually, you know what also looks really gorgeous. One thing that also looks really gorgeous, even though I haven't played it, is Bound for the PS4, where everything you do is some kind of dancer's move. Do you know what I'm talking about?
No. I've heard it.
Just when you walk, you're doing, like, I don't know the names of any of this stuff, so I'm going to come off like a fool, but, like everything you do is some kind of dance move or step, and when you're jumping across platforms, you're doing that, like, ballerina sort of, like, long leap kind of thing, whatever that's called. Someone's gonna correct me on this, but, like, everything you do is in some way inspired by, like, high art dance, and it's kind of amazing, even if you're, like, a dance pleb like me.
Nice.
Yeah, so, by the way, next question, the Fool Arcana, and, I mean, spoilers from Minty Mitz, but, have you ever done cosplay? And if so, what was it of? There's a second question, but we'll start with this one. My answer is no, so that's an easy one. But you guys?
My answer is no, too, but I will be doing one, hopefully, if I finish it in time for MAGFest.
Ooh.
You guys have always known that I've wanted to do a very specific cosplay for a long time, and I just have never done it because of how intricate it needs to be.
Mm-hmm.
I'm a huge fan of the Berserk series of manga, and I've been reading it ever since basically high school, I think. And I really like the main character, and I think I can look like him if I got the right haircut and that kind of thing. So I feel like I could pull that off. However, I've also realized that he has so many accessories.
A surprising amount.
He has full armor. He has full armor for most of his incarnations, so I kind of wanted to do the young version of him as well, but that would still be difficult as well. So I want to do it eventually, but I just haven't had the guts to do it.
go as the Skull Knight. That's much easier.
Would you like to have the sword made out of foam, or would you rather it be more actual wood? There lies that question now with the woodwork.
So if I made it out of foam, it would be good for toting it around, because he for anybody who doesn't know, the main character has a gigantic sword. He was probably the first character in anime to have and Japanese culture to have a gigantic sword like
that. Yeah, I heard that it influenced or inspired Cloud's Buster Sword from Final Fantasy VII.
Exactly. Yeah. So like, this character's been around for a long time, and he has this gigantic sword. So, like, you also need to make your cosplay, like, practical enough so you can get around in it.
Mm-hmm.
Convention rule says as long as your cosplay prop is under 6 feet tall, I think that's the limit.
That might be a problem, because Guts' sword is taller than his.
yeah, it's taller than him to some degree. So, you also need to make it in a way that you don't hate carrying it around, mm-hmm. too. Like, ideally, I would want to make it out of wood, but, like, wood is a lot heavier than foam is.
You could make it, like, a wood center, a metal center, perhaps, even, and then foam it up on as the outside.
Yeah, and I would just be afraid of it getting damaged. That's the only thing. So I would need to take good care of it, I think. But I think I can do it. But I'm also getting to the point where I don't want to go to anime conventions anymore. So, because I'm less into anime and just, like, good stuff in general. Like, I don't follow anime just because it's anime.
Mm-hmm.
I will still watch a great anime series because it's a great series. But I don't follow anime because it's anime, like I used to. Kind of like I don't follow comic books like that much anymore. Like I will buy a trade paperback of something that's fantastic, because I heard it's great, but I won't follow the hobby from month to month, that kind of thing. So just to give you an idea, the last anime that I watched was Gurren Lagann. So like that was quite a bit of time ago. Not that I tried to watch a couple other animes all the way through, and I just I got distracted. So there are a couple that I really like that I've seen since then. So don't think that I haven't watched anything at all. But the last show that I watched to completion was that. But I've seen a couple other OVAs and stuff like that though, in the meantime. So I think I would like to do that, but it's one of those things that I would need to work on for a really long time, and hopefully. I would look good, after I lost some weight too, looking like that character.
Well,
so
whenever you think you're ready, we have people, we have places, and you have prop masters that can help you with this.
Mm-hmm.
Awesome! I really appreciate that.
And Minty Miss, have you done cosplay before?
I've done cosplay for a pretty long time. It's not always like I don't do it for like I don't do photo shoots or anything like that I don't do hardcore stuff, but most of the time I just make something, do the props, mostly as like a hobby.
Mm-hmm.
I believe I started cosplaying back in like 2007, so it's like 10 years.
What characters have you done?
I've done in the beginning I done a Bleach character. I done one of the lieutenants in the series. I forgot. It's so long ago. It's just like I did one of the like vice lieutenants or something. Mm-hmm. Nanao, I did Nanao in because I kind of look like her. And then from there, I did some of the more, I guess. I did Sailor Moon. I did Sailor Saturn for like the Sailor Moon series with a group of friends.
Nice.
Mm-hmm.
See, I also did Fang from Final Fantasy 13. That's how I got into the woodworking, actually. Making her staff was actually very difficult. Therefore, like, when you have that Dremel power is, like, unreal when you can finally make something of your own.
When I buy my house, I want to get, like, a whole bunch of tools, and Dremel is, like, right on the top of the list, along with, like, all the electronics tools that I really want.
One day I will refer to you to one of my friends, Miss Mana. He's the one that sort of taught me all of this, the usage of tools and everything for cosplay reasons and props. And then things here and there in between, anything that's like very easy to dress up in. I wouldn't say I have done any hardcore armors in any way or form. I think if refer to my sisters are actually more of cosplayers than I am. They dress up at every convention, whereas I dress up in whichever one I feel like, depending on whichever convention, because like there are some conventions that are very based on cosplaying and everybody's just cosplaying even one day or another, or all 3 days, etc. And then there are some conventions that are you can cosplay, you don't have to cosplay, either or is okay, but maybe you get like 60% people are not cosplaying. One of those conventions I'll just walk around normal clothing.
Mm-hmm.
For sure.
Right. So I guess the last bit then, because Full Arcana had two questions. The second one is, what is your guilty pleasure game, meaning a game you can admit is flawed on a gameplay and or narrative level, yet you still can't help enjoying? There's probably a lot of those. You know, I don't play anything that's perfect, or that came out a little weird. Nothing is perfect, so, like, there's always something that's flawed in some way that I'm like, whatever I like. But if you want to go for guilt, like, I should feel bad about liking this one, like, I've talked about this before, but for some reason, I am okay with Quest 64 and I don't know if I would be now, but I at least was okay with Castlevania 64.
Yeah, so Castlevania 64 isn't that bad.
The controls are, even then, the controls were like, but it's an alright game, or at least from what I remember of it.
It has some really good moments in it.
I think I've said this before, but the final form of Dracula is my favorite of any final form of Dracula I've seen in a Castlevania series.
And I really like the hedge maze.
That was amazing.
Fight. That's really great. And the remake of it is quite good. Not a fantastic game, but it's fun.
You know, one thing I remember that was kind of cool was the second boss in the game was a vampire that you walk in on him and you see him just chewing on some woman's neck, and he gets up and he's like, and he fights you, and it's a boss fight, and you finally beat the vampire, and then the woman who he'd been eating gets up and she's part two of the fight. You just gotta fight another one now. You're just like, oh my god, no. It was pretty cool.
That's awesome. Yeah.
You know, like Resident Evil's done stuff like that on a smaller scale. When the zombie's eating a body, the zombie gets up, then the body gets up, and you're like, crap.
I would say that my guilty pleasure that's like this is, you know, basically a bad game that, like, people talk crap on that I actually like playing is Silver Surfer. So,
okay.
For NES. So a lot of people talk crap on this game, and I think it's just really hard. I don't know whether it's designed. I think it's designed poorly in the sense that it's super frustrating for people to play, and you shouldn't make your game super frustrating. But the game is hard as balls.
yeah.
And I like playing it because I love shmups in general, and the music is fantastic. And I also just like seeing how far. I like seeing how far I can get in the game. I can't beat it, but. Through I guess the faults in the game itself, but it's hard as shit, and I still kind of love it for it. I love it for its, like, I don't know, kind of like I want to be the guy-ness,
okay,
of that kind of thing. It's so hard that I want to beat it, you know what I mean? Like, it's the mountain I must climb. and so many other people hate it, but they kind of like watching me play it. Like, a few of my friends like watching me play it. So, and also the fact that I can actually beat more than a couple levels. People are always mystified. They're like, wow, you can actually, like, get somewhere in this game rather than just be giving up after the first level, which is what a lot of people do.
Yeah, so. Any level in that game, like, they're beatable, but I mean, good luck, especially if you're just going into it like, oh, Silver Surfer, let's play Silver Surfer. Like, it's brutal.
It's a fucking hard game.
I think my game was like, who was this? Seiken Densetsu 3? That's like from like really back in the days.
Oh, that's a great game, though.
Yeah, I usually play it on, like, I didn't, of course, when I was younger, I didn't have, like, an emulator or anything like that. I mean, I didn't have, like, a real game, but I downloaded an emulator for it, and that's what I used to play, and I would play, I don't know, something about that game is just, like, very, very easy to replay over and over again, easy load, easy.
So that's replay. More like comfort food for you, I would say, then, wouldn't you say?
Yeah, as in a bit, yeah, I would say, as a game back in the day, that would be one of the games I would just easily just go back to. Not sure about flawed in a sense. I don't know, I don't have any notable flaws I could actually point out, but it is a game that I would just go back to, time to time.
Sure. How about you, Pyro?
I've been trying to think of one, and I can't really think of a game that... I mean, I can think of many games that I'd go back to and play multiple times, but not really any that I would consider like a guilty pleasure game in a way that it's not the best game, but I still enjoy playing it. I would say to answer the question of the what I don't think is a flawed game that I'd go back to is probably Yoshi's Island for Super Nintendo.
Sure, that would be your comfort food.
Also, great visual game.
That and Earthbound, both games that I really enjoy going back to and playing over and over again.
Mm.
I don't really know. I guess there was actually this Super Nintendo game that I played a lot back in college called Robotech. It was a Super Nintendo game.
That game's cool.
Yeah,
Robotrek.
Robotrek, yeah. That game I find is pretty flawed, but I still like playing it just because it has mechs that you can kind of put together and fight with.
It's almost like Pokemon, almost, right?
Kind of, but like instead of collecting different mechs, you collected different parts to power up your one mech. So it was a really interesting game. I guess another game that you could say is flawed is Legend of Mana for PlayStation.
Okay.
A lot of people like that game.
A lot of people do, though. But it's like a really weird game, and it's the first Mana game that kind of is not like any of the other ones, and I think that's why a lot of people
didn't
like it.
It kind of goes off the rails a little bit.
Yeah, but and it was really weird to play because the quests you get really depends on how you put together your world. And it's just strange all around, and I know that a lot of people like it, but also a lot of people didn't like it because of that, but I really enjoyed playing that game, and I've beaten it, like, at least 3 or 4 times when I have time
to
do
that. I need to check that out. That's just one of those series that's never clicked with me, the Mana games.
Mm-hmm.
I know that you guys love them, and a lot of other people love them, but every time I try to go back and play Secret of Mana, I can't get into it for some reason. I don't know what it is. But I know I must be wrong if enough people like it that much.
Maybe the genre doesn't suit what you kind of like, you know?
Yeah, but I love action RPGs. Like, action RPGs are, like, my favorite genre, pretty much. So I don't know why those games in particular don't sync with me. I just don't understand it. So I think it's just maybe... I think it's the menu system kind of bugs me. Maybe because, like, it interrupts the gameplay in kind of annoying way, and I think there should be more shortcuts. If that makes sense, there should be a button that is like mapped to healing, that kind of thing. There should be a button that's mapped so that your one character can do magic.
Yeah, because you have to go to the menu every spell. Single time. Yeah, I like that they took away a little bit from the Legend of Mana game, but yeah, that was one thing that was really annoying in the Super Nintendo ones.
Yeah, so that's probably, if I had to nail it, like why I don't like them, that's probably it.
All right, well, that's
just kind of a slog.
That that I think has is the time we have for today regarding all that.
Yeah, yeah, I think we've done some damage there.
Mm-hmm.
All right, well, if that's the case, then we will do our sign off here. I want to thank our listeners for a half of a year of loyalty here. This is the 26th episode, therefore it's a whole half year we've been putting out a podcast every single week. We haven't missed a week.
Mm-hmm. Nice.
Thankfully, you know, we've had a couple where we had to do it a couple days late, but we've always gotten one out. So and I think Pyro's been here ever since he's been a regular.
Mm-hmm.
You haven't missed an episode, so and Lotus as well, and myself. So I'm really enjoying the dedication to this, and I'm really enjoying the dedication of our very frequent commenters. We have a few commenters out there that comment every single episode, and I really thank your thank you for your enthusiasm. You're our biggest supporters, and please help spread the word.
Mm-hmm.
About the podcast. This is going to be a bigger thing as time goes on as well. I want to do a few things also to help increase our presence online. So I think eventually I want to start putting a few of the things that we talk about into the title of the podcast post, because the way YouTube's search algorithms work, it's not going to pull up with anybody trying to look up, you know, corrective consciousness,
sure.
For instance. You know, nobody's going to look that up. So if they look up something like Zelda, they might come across us, you know, just by happenstance. So there are a few things that I want to get going with, but I think our format is very solid, and we're moving forward here. So I want to thank our special guests as well. Minty Mints, thank you very much for coming on a second time here.
And, thank you for inviting me.
Yeah, I think you are a great addition to our regular stable of guest stars. So I really want to thank you for making it on again, and I hope you come again soon.
Thank you. Yeah.
So, having said that, I would like to ask everybody to keep giving us thumbs up, keep giving us 5-star reviews on iTunes so we can get a public rating, and share us on Facebook and Twitter and everything you can. And find me on PSN, on Steam, on pretty much anything. Xbox as well. I'm Vise the Bold on anything you can think of. VyseTheBold. Anybody else want to do a plug while we're at it?
Just feel free to hit me up on the comments or messages section of YouTube or at Lotus Prince on Twitter.
Yeah, I was going to say feel free to meet with us at MAGFest if you come across us. I know you don't...
Faux show.
None of you really know what we look like, but... if you leave comments, we could probably find a time to meet up and introduce ourselves and whatnot.
In fact, don't forget,
you guys can all just loudly talk all the time, so they'll recognize your voice.
Oh my gosh.
Yeah, just do the loudest Colossus roar you can, and we'll be there.
Just, I'm Pyro Jack Frost, I'm Pyro Jack Frost, I'm Pyro Jack Frost. Oh, there he is.
Buys the bulb, buys the bulb, buys the bulb.
That's so irritating.
Just do a recording. Save your voice.
Yeah, what we'll do is I'll post a spot in which we can meet up on the YouTube page and see if anybody can join us.
Yeah, sure.
All right. Well, thanks a lot, and don't forget to friend me on Twitter as well. Again, as Vise the Bold. So have a great day, and we'll catch you next week. If we don't catch up, MAGFest.
Until next time.
Also, Happy New Year's, everybody.
It's true.
Yeah, Happy New Year. Happy 2017.
Until next time, everyone.